Very good afternoon, everyone. I, Ms. Ketki Ghawali, Branch Mentor, IEEE VSIT Student Branch, warmly welcome all of you to the final day of Mind Quench, the Quarantine Special Webinar Series. These 4 days of learning together has certainly made us happier and feeling more productive. I know that you all too have thoroughly enjoyed the webinars, and it really means a lot to us. Today, on day 5 of Mind Quench, we will learn about a very interesting topic by none other than Mr. Kiran Talele, an Associate Professor, Electronics Engineering Department, SPIT. Before we begin, I would like to add a gentle reminder for all the participants to keep their mics on mute and video off throughout the webinar. Ensure they have entered the webinar with their full names. Use the chat box to ask questions, if any. We will be sharing the feedback form. We will be sharing the feedback form link in the chat box towards the end of the webinar. Kindly ensure you submit your feedback before you leave the webinar. Also, for the certificate, you may have to wait for another 24 hours. So today's webinar on emotion detection using facial expression recognition will be delivered by Mr. Kiran Talele. Apart from being an associate professor at the Electronics Engineering Department, SPIT, sir is also the Student Activities Committee Chair, IEEE Bombay Section. He is the Chief Finance Officer and Head of Academic Relations at Sardar Patel Technology Business Incubator, and is in charge of Innovation and Entrepreneurship Development Center, supported by DST, Government of India. His areas of research are digital signal and image processing, computer vision and machine learning, and multimedia system design. Mr. Talele has published more than 70 research papers at various national and international referee conferences and journals, and has filed and published 8 patents at the Indian Patent Office. Sir, we are glad to have you here for today's webinar. I would now request sir to kindly take the session ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon to one and all. Today's topic is emotion detection using facial expression recognition. Facial expressions are the immediate reaction on the facial region due to emotional state of the mind. So whenever we look at the person, what we get is facial expression. But we have to detect the emotion that is hidden inside the body, and that emotion we have to detect. So today, first I'll show you some possible reactions. Can we make out these different emotional reactions by the person? All these are realistic views. There are many reactions. So what we see here is the expressions on the face part, which has resulted because of emotional state of the mind. So there are happy expression, there are sad expression, there are disgust expression, there are unhappy fear expression, there are angry expressions, and contempt expression, sleepy expression, many. Look at this. The difference between this picture is these are extreme reaction, immediate reaction. There also includes mix of two reactions. So certain parts of the images are hidden of some other part. So this is the challenge for the facial expression recognition research group to identify the correct emotions, even though image part is hidden. So certain parts of the facial part is hidden. This covered by fingers and like that. Okay, these are also extreme reactions. Now, among all these multiple reactions, total there are 300 different reactions which has been identified. 300 different reactions. All 300 different reactions cannot be identified, because there's a possibility that these are mixed reactions. So definitely, we want to find out, to start with, the basic system which will consider a few universal reactions. Which are the universal reactions?
Can you make out from this? I displayed this universal reactions here. One is happy expression. The first one, left hand side, called angry expression. So this angry expression is universal reaction. Second is happy. Second person, first line, is a happy expression. It's not important whether the person, it's not gender specific. It is not particular area wise. It is open for all. And this is a basic reaction. Third one is surprise. He's suddenly surprised by looking at it. Next line is second one, happy, angry, sad, fear. These are the different reactions. So in that, I just select six expressions: sad, anger, disgust, fear, and surprise. These are the expressions. When you see reaction on the face, there's always some changes on the body part. Some changes are always there on the body part. For example, when you are sad, there will be a change on the forehead part. When you are anger, the lips will get tightened. When you are disgust, nose will get squinted. When you are in fear state, eyes get open and mouth get elongated. If you are surprised, mouth gets open circularly and eyes gets tightened like that. If you are happy, then mouth get elongated. So for every expression, there is some immediate reaction on the facial part, facial region. Those immediate reaction we have to capture. Now, when we talk about the image recognition system, image facial expression recognition system, we need to do it offline using system, using computer. So in that case, what we want to do here is we want to develop a system. Everything has to be done by computer. So to develop this system, we have to consider two parts. One is the training part, second is the testing part. First, we have to train the system. For training part, whether it's a training or testing, the first step is always image pre-processing. So if you're taking the video image, then you have to decompose this video image into different pictures. We call it frame. So every video image in 1 second of time, there are 30 frames. You can select alternate frame because that much of clarity is not required, that much of variation not required. So we can take alternate frame. So let's say we have video separated in terms of frame and we select alternate frame. So when we select the frame, that frame has to be processed. After that, we need to detect the face part of it, because emission based on facial expression means you have to detect the face part. Now there's a possibility that face may get tilted, so we'll have to normalize it. So that face will be oriented in frontal direction. Then we need to compare the face. We need to train the system. Whenever we do testing, there has to be some comparison. So we have to maintain one database of all the emotions. And whenever the new picture comes, that we have to compare it with the stored information. When we have to compare the stored information, comparison is never done point by point. If you do it by point by point, because of some intensity variation, color variation, there'll be some mismatch. So to avoid this mismatch, we need to compare feature by features. Features of the objects are calculated. For example, if I take the object of duster. When we say duster, we know that duster is a rectangular shape type. The shape of the duster is rectangular. So we need to compare the object which is stored in the memory whose shape is rectangular type. Now there may be multiple objects having the same shape. So we need to go one step ahead. So we need to compare with the color of the duster. We need to compare the texture of the duster. And then based on that, we take a decision that the object is a duster. So when we compare the stored object with the input object, we never compare point by point. We always compare features wise. Feature can be based on certain parameter. So what are the features? How to extract the features? What do you mean by features? How many features to extract? How to compare it? That everything we are going to discuss in today's session. So we have to extract the features. After that, we have to train the system. We need to train the system, means we need to train our computer. This is called training part. After the training is over, we'll get some train vector. For every emotion, there'll be one train vector. Those vectors are stored in the memory. We never stored images for comparison. We stored the features of an object. The features are denoted by vector. So those train vectors of every possible image is stored in the memory. So let's say there are six basic expressions. So for six basic expressions, there'll be six vectors. So let's say we have happy expression.
So first we take 100 images of happy expression. Then we calculate the train vector. For every image, we calculate some vector, some parameter, some shape. We calculate a certain features. Then for every 100 image, we'll be calculating this value. Average of that value will be our final training vector. Then we take next expression, surprise expression. All surprise expression images we will take. And then we'll calculate the features. Average of that we'll calculate. And then features we'll get it. So for every expression, we'll get one training vector. Those training vectors are expression specific. After that, for testing, we take the new image. That training vector is also required for testing. So we take the new image, do the processing part, remove the noise, detect the face. If the face is not oriented in front of direction, we rotate it, and then we calculate the features. Those features are compared with the stored feature, training field, and then final decision is taken. So we'll go in detail about it. So basically, there are three important blocks: face pre-processing, feature extraction, and expression detection and classification. Now, for training, we need to take image data, then classify it, new image data, and then testing it, and then view the output. So pre-processing. Pre-processing, I have just taken a sample example. You take the input image, then do the face detection, and then face normalization, face become the frontal direction. Now, there are so many features specification. There are so many features. So many features are there. I'll be taking a couple of features. One example is local binary pattern feature descriptor. What is this local binary pattern? Local binary pattern basically extract the textural part. If you see the face, there are two type of part. Texture means entire present in the image. And second part is age information. Ages are obtained because of wrinkle effect on the face. Whenever you use some expression on the face part, you'll get a lot of lines. Those lines are called ages. Those lines are called wrinkles. For example, if I smile, then my lips will get open up. And then there'll be some age effect on the lip part. If I cry, then all eyes will become small, and then nose part will get squeezed. My cheek part will get tightened. And then so many ages will come on the part. So that is called wrinkle. Those wrinkles are different part. Local binary part is a different part. Local binary part is because of lighting effect on the facial part. So we need to calculate this local binary pattern. How to calculate this LBP vector? Let's say this is the input face pattern. For this input face pattern, internally, there's a matrix. In that, there are pixel values. Everybody knows what is pixel value. So we have to select the face 3x3 window. So I'm selecting the face of 3x3 size. This is the face part. Inside, internally, what we see on the screen is an image. What is there in the memory is the numbers. Let's say these are the numbers. Few numbers are displayed. Out of that, you select 3x3 numbers. So this is called window. This window is selected. This window is taken further for calculation. Now, in the first part, there's a window. Center pixel is 54. All this outer pixel value will have to compare with the center pixel value. Now you tell me, 65, the first value is 65. 65 is greater than 54, less than 54. 65 is greater than 54. So when it is greater than 54, my first B7 value in the LBP coded block will be 1. Then 79. Is 79 greater than 54? Yes. Then this will go to position 1. Like that, every value will have to check whether it is greater than center pixel value or less than center pixel value. If it is greater, then the value is 1. If it is smaller, then the value is 0. So look at, we get LBP coded block 11010011. These are the values that we obtain. How did you get this value? By comparing the border pixel value with the center pixel value. Border value larger than center, then it is 1. If it is smaller, then it is 0. Traverse these pixels in a clockwise direction from the upper leftmost corner. So I written all these values on LBP code. Upper line 110, then right corner 010001. Then 111. Convert this binary number to decimal number. So the current equivalent decimal number is 211. This 211 will get stored in the output image at the appropriate position. So when we have to calculate LBP value, we have to follow this procedure.
at each and every location. And this way we get LBP image. Now getting LBP image is not sufficient. We need to calculate the feature vector. Feature we have to calculate. This is the intermediate step that is called local binary pattern. Normally, the image is decomposed into two parts or three parts or four parts or multiple parts. It is observed that whenever the LBP code is calculated on the entire image, the results are not at all good. So we need to decompose this image into smaller block and then calculate the image. So I done this two parts. Look at this upper part and lower part. For upper part, LBP image is calculated. For lower part, LBP image is calculated. Calculation of LBP image, I discussed with you earlier. And then from this, we have to calculate feature vector. That feature vector written on the right hand side in the graphical form, there I written 0 to 255. You take example of any image, no matter whether it's input image or output image, values are always in the range of 0 to 255. So we want to find out in the input image, how many times 0 is present, how many times 1 is present, how many times 2 is present, maximum value is 255, how many times 255 is present in the input image. That is called feature vector. So the feature vector is basically a number telling us how many times every particular pixel value is present in the image. Total number of pixels are in the range of 0 to 255. That means 256. 256 for the first part, 256 values for the second part. Total number of values will be 512. 512 values are actually vector. LBP histogram vector, that is called histogram vector. That means original input image is now replaced by 512 values only. Those 512 values are compared with 512 values of stored image and not the entire image. So there are so many other variations. I'll be going to the bidirectional LBP. Look at this bidirectional LBP. I've taken this example where the input block, there are the LBP image is calculated and LBP image is scanned clockwise in the first part and scanned anti-clockwise in the second part. Clockwise scanning, anti-clockwise scan. So when we go clockwise, digital value is 211. When we go anti-clockwise, digital value is 229. 211 is stored in one image, 229 is stored in another image. So we got two images, one by clock going clockwise and second by going anti-clockwise. This is called bidirectional LBP. So let's take the same example. Take the input image. Take the two parts, upper part, lower parts. Upper part, binary image, clockwise, binary image, LBP binary image, anti-clockwise is obtained. Again, for both, vectors are calculated. Now number of vectors are increased. Initially, we had only 512 vectors. Now we have 1024 vectors. Number of vectors are increased. Number of vectors are increased, so strength of the vector is also increased. The paucity of correct recognition is also increased. So when we keep on increasing the strength of the feature vector by adding more and more meaningful information, the efficiency of recognition of correct expression increases. To increase the efficiency, we have to increase the strength of the feature vector. So this is the one possibility. This is unidirectional feature vector. What I've shown here is a bidirectional feature vector. Definitely, the result of unidirectional feature vector is not good. Bidirectional feature vector is good. Another feature vector is histogram of gradient, histogram of oriented gradient. So these two examples, two or three feature vector, I'll take it. There are a lot of research going on. People are developing new constructing new feature vector and using those feature vector, they are applying for problem of recognition. And research has gone to the state that people are able to categorize 99% with 99% efficiency of recognition. So here gradient means change of pixel value in x direction, in y direction. So there are two directions for the image, a vertical direction and horizontal direction. So we have to calculate a change of nearby pixel value. You take any point, take the next point on the image. What is the change? Value increase or decrease? That you have to find. So every pixel, next pixel will have to compare and decide whether the value is increased or decreased. And then what are the answers we get? The difference is calculated. Present value and the next pixel value. The difference can be positive, the difference can be negative. So we'll have to calculate the magnitude. Magnitude always gives positive value. So there are two parameters that is calculated, magnitude and direction. Magnitude gives difference difference, absolute of difference, and direction gives angle value in which direction it is going. It is the angle between these two values. Based on that, histogram is calculated, and the feature vector is called histogram of gradient. So look at here, gradient, and okay, I just want to skip this part. There is a procedure from these values to calculate the gradient, and then we get entire block, replace it by 9 values. 0 to 160, these are the angle values, and using this angle value, based on the magnitude, the values are calculated. So there is some procedure to calculate this angle value. Now, another procedure is, another feature specification is digital signals signature feature descriptor. Signature feature descriptor. Look at this image. We want to calculate digital signal signature. Digital signature is the feature vector describing the original image. The size of the original image is always very, very large. We don't require entire image for comparison. We just need to do a features for comparison. As I given you the example of duster, we don't require the image of duster for comparison. We just need to know the shape of the duster for comparison. Obviously, the comparison is constrained with the objects which are there in the database. We cannot just make it generalized. So we need to develop this application for unknown objects. So when we have to compare the facial images with another facial images, we don't need to compare point by point. We need to compare feature by feature. So the third example of features, I'm telling you how to calculate it. Look at this image. This image, internally, let's say we calculate edges. Edges are very important. Lines are called edges. These edges are effect of emotional state on the facial part. So whenever we cry, whenever we smile, whenever we get surprised, fear, angry expression, all these expressions give certain lines effect on the screen, on the facial region. Those lines will have to encode, and those lines will have to compare it with the stored images lines. So this information, this intermediate stage, first you have to obtain the edges. To obtain the edges, there are so many functions available, and then we have to find out the signature of it. See, for example, whenever we go to the bank, we don't attach our picture on the check part. We just put our signature, and signature is compared with the stored signature. And based on that, we say that the person is authenticated. For example, in your case, whenever you enter to the college, we have to give some number, roll number or exam number during exam time. We don't have to upload your picture or photograph. So your identification is based on your number. Like that, our identification in banking sector is based on the signature value. So whenever there's an image, we call it signature. Signature is a feature vector describing the original image. So I'm explaining the method to calculate the signature. Project all these values horizontally. Project all these values vertically. That is called vertical signature, horizontal signature. How to calculate horizontal signature? Project the values horizontally. How to project it? This is the image. When I say image, on the screen we get visual effect. In the memory is the numbers. I calculated edges. Edges means binary image. Binary means value will be either 1 or 0. So count a number of 1s horizontally. In each row, find out how many 1s are there. We'll compute the number of 1s vertically, number of 1s horizontally, and this will give projection vector in vertical direction as well as horizontal direction. These vectors are concatenated. Surprisingly, this has given excellent result. This type of techniques are used in computer vision. So there are two type of classification, two-class classification, multi-class classification. SVM is a classification technique. The technique is called support vector machine classification technique. So we'll not go in detail for this. I just want to tell you that there are two classes, two-class and multi-class. In two-class, there are only class one, class two. So happy and surprises can be positive emotions. Disgust, unhappy, fear, angry can be negative emotion. And we can classify it based on which are positive emotion, which are negative emotion. But if there are multi-classification, then first you have to classify into happy and surprise separately, disgust, unhappy, fear, angry separately. So input image may fall into upper class or lower class. If it goes to upper class, then one more classification we have to do, happy and surprise. If it is lower class, then we'll have to do two classifications, disgust, unhappy, fear, angry, or disgust, unhappy separately, fear, angry separately. So we have to keep on classifying in three stages. This is called two-class classification for multi-class classification problem. So these are the examples of databases which are available. Khan Kanade facial expression database, Taiwanese facial expression database, Japanese facial expression database, Indian facial expression database, For Indian, I had taken child database, young people database, middle-aged people database, old age database, different age databases are created for comparison. So here there are three algorithms which I'm going to highlight it in two minutes only. Basically, algorithms are extraction of features and use of feature for classification. So first is using LPP histogram feature descriptor. I explain you three type of feature vector. One is LPP, second is projection, and third is histogram of gradient. I'll just skip this part. Image is decomposed into four parts. Image can be decomposed into two parts. Image can be decomposed into four parts. So the example is decomposition of image into four parts, decomposition of image into five parts. It is observed that when we decompose the image into five parts, look at here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 parts. The fifth part is a centroid of the face. This centroid of the face is the expression rich area. But that is not only sufficient for recognition of image. We need to consider other region also. So definitely the addition of extra block increases the strength of the feature vector and increases the efficiency of the recognition. So here I compare this efficiency. Efficiency gives how many images are successfully recognized. You'll find that with 5 block, efficiency of recognition increases. So I explain you one method using LBP. Second method is using projection vector. Projection vector we can calculate into vertical direction, horizontal direction. So there are 5 blocks. 5 blocks are preferred because 5 blocks strength increases. Horizontal edge detection, vertical edge detection. Look at here. This is the input image. All horizontal images are edges are detected. In second line, all vertical edges are detected. So we are getting two type of edges, vertical edges and horizontal edges. First face is detected. Blocks, images are decomposed into different block. Vertical edge is obtained, vertical features are obtained. Horizontal image is obtained, horizontal features are obtained. Every time we have to obtain features. How to obtain feature? By projecting it horizontally, by projecting it vertically. Projection means counting the number of ones in vertical line, counting the number of ones in horizontal line. So this way we get projection vector. When we do this, the efficiency of recognition increases. So one method is do it horizontally, do it vertically separately. Second method is that find out the edges which itself will give you projection in vertical and horizontal in the same time. So this example of image, as I explained you earlier, for the same image, horizontal description, horizontal parameters are calculated and vertical parameters are calculated. And these feature vectors are concatenated. So this is very good example that edge is detected, vertical projection is obtained, horizontal projection is obtained. These projection vectors are combined and then we get a projection vector. So this is combination of LBP as well as projection vector. LBP image I explained you earlier, bidirectional LBP, unidirectional LBP. This is the example of only unidirectional LBP. And then projection vectors are added. When we keep on adding two or more feature vector, the number of vector increases, but the strength also increases. This way, the efficiency of recognition increases. Here it shows that efficiency of red color, efficiency of recognition is better than earlier method. See, here I'm interested to highlight you different possibilities, how these feature extractions are done and how to make use of this feature extraction for classification. So this is another method where we can merge the feature vector. So there are two techniques. One is concatenation, one is merging. So this is the two methods where features are concatenated one after the other. Ek ke baad dusra. And this is merging in between feature extraction, merging, mixing. Mixing in between gives better results as compared to adding the feature vector one by one. So efficiency of recognition, correct efficiency of recognition increases when feature vectors are fused to each other. For fusion, there are so many techniques. Feature extraction, there are multiple techniques. We have to do a lot of experimentation and find out which technique is suitable for in what application, in application context. This is the third case and the last case where all these feature vectors are combined. LBP feature vector is combined with histogram of gradient, with edge detection projection vector. Fusion is also done. Definitely, efficiency of recognition is the best in this case. If you see this example, there are different methodology. One is using only LVP, second is using only projection, third is using mixing of all these feature vector. Mixing means hybrid. In the last 5 years, lot of research is going on only on hybrid feature extraction. Hybrid feature extraction means mixing two or more feature vector and then applying it for classification and getting the result. Here I taken one realistic emotional state of happy expression. This is the happy person. But you know, when we say happy, there is not only single expression for happy. There are multiple happy expression in realistic view. What are the example that I taken earlier, the basic expression, and in that basic expression, I taken only one happy expression. And that happy expressions are peak happy expression. But whereas here, there are so many happy expression. So H1 is weak happy expression. H2 is weak happy expression. H3 is moderate happy expression. H4 is peak happy expression. H5 is mix of happy expression. Feeling shy also. And then there are multiple ways of happy expression, mixing multiple action and reaction. Definitely, we need to train the system to accommodate all possibilities and then find out whether we are able to successfully recognize or not. As you know, as number of expressions are closer to other expressions, possibility of wrong recognition is also more. So this is the challenge. Another challenge is, look at here. They are mixing up expression. First is sadly fearful. It's not only sad, it's not only fear, sadly angry, sadly surprised, hate filled, multiple mix of reaction. When we train the system for basics recognition, the system will fail to recognize such type of reaction. So these are the challenges for future generation to identify this correct emotion. This challenge is occluded faces. The face region is occluded, is not frontal direction, first thing. Second, the entire face region is not clearly visible. Only 50 to 80% face is visible. And there's a possibility that the recognition will fail. So efficiency of recognition not only depends on how you train the system, it also depends on quality of the input image. What type of input image we are handling? These are the realistic images. Definitely in realistic images, the orientation of the face or head is not frontal direction. Color information or lighting intensity is not uniform on the entire face. These are the challenges that is to be covered. Here also, there are mix of reaction as well as face is also hidden. Okay, this is all about 14 minutes I covered. Where we require this facial expression recognition system? We require this recognition for patient. If you go to the ICU unit, you'll find that patients are admitted to the hospital and nobody is there to look after them. So if the patient is experiencing pain, then if there's a visual system, then vision-based system can capture the video of the patient and can make out whenever there's a angry face, disgust face, fear face, negative emotions are detected. Second is, if the person is doing some crime, then definitely the effect will come on the face part. If you go to the airport or any public space, if somebody's actions are suspicious, then his facial expression will also change. And based on those two actions, we can make out whether the person's intention. So intention can also be attended. This is all about emotion detection using facial expression. My slides are shared with you. Now, you ask me questions.
Seema ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes, we'll take the question from here. I'm there. I'll just start here.
I've been given 5 questions. Should I answer those questions first?
Sir, Seema ma'am will be asking you the question and you will be answering.
Okay.
Those were the collections which we have collected from the registration form. But Seema ma'am will be asking you, and we have one or two questions from the chat box also. So she will be asking, sir. Just wait for 1 minute. Seema ma'am, please continue.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, sir, for sharing this information with you. Your session was very informative. I am Seema Bhattar, branch manager, IEEE VSIT student branch. I would like to present some questions that participants have asked. So the first question was from Sanket Chavan, but that question I think we have covered. He was asked for, you know, explaining or emphasizing some algorithms for facial recognition. So I think already you have covered. So we'll go for the second question, sir. Okay. Yeah. So, or you wanted to emphasize more on this?
Just one second. When you say algorithm, there in every algorithm, there are only two parts. Extraction of features and classification. Now, features are, n number of features are there. N number of features, hundreds of features are there. So we have to find out most effective features, extraction of features, and second is the classification. Classification also, there are hundreds of techniques. Whatever I selected here, these are the current state of the research. If you see the last 5 years publication, these techniques are actually developed. So these techniques give best result. Around 98% efficiency is obtained using this technique. So I mentioned three techniques. One is local binary pattern, second is projection factor, and third is histogram of gradient feature vector. If you combine all these three vectors and then do the classification, you'll get a best result. That is the algorithm.
The next question. The next question is by Bhairavi Savan Desai from Vidyalanka School of Information Technology. The question is, can you tell us about the camera modules which we can use for image processing?
Okay. There is no hard and fast rule which camera we should use. The camera resolution, as the camera resolution increases, the number of pixels will increase, and that will create a lot of burden on the algorithm. So there is no as specified camera module for image processing application. You can use even any web camera. You can use any camera. In fact, I would suggest you, it totally depends on application to application. Not all the applications same camera is required. For example, all biomedical application, high resolution camera is required. Whereas all scene, natural scene, facial expression, object detection, low resolution camera can also be used. So camera module depends on application, and it the cost also depends on the resolution of the camera. So any camera module will do for image processing application. For basic application, web camera will also do.
Very well answered, sir. I think so. This is the perfect one.
Yeah.
We'll go for the next, sir. The third question is by Farin Shabir Sheikh from Vidyalanka School of Information Technology. The question is, how much can AI understand human emotions by using facial recognition? 80% or more than this? If yes, then how? And if no, then how?
Okay. Current state of the research which I have implemented, what people have published and developed, the current efficiency is about 98% for basic expressions, for laboratory constrained facial images, frontal face. But if you take realistic images, then efficiency is around 90%. 80% is much beyond 80%. It totally depends on what type of features you extract and how you do pre-processing of image. If your pre-processing is very strong, then using the proper feature vector, we can use the classification technique to give better results. So most important part is feature extraction. If your features extraction technique is not powerful, feature strength is not good, then efficiency will degrade. So AI, artificial intelligence means training the system, adding the intelligence to the system to recognize it. So basically, we need to do training using neural network technique or any other AI technique. But basically for training, what we require is the proper set of feature vectors. And with that, we can achieve more than 90% efficiency. Over.
So the next question is by Megha Kolekar from Rodrigues Institute of Technology. The question is, can you please provide information how to acquire Indian face databases? Are there any special requirements for database that can be uploaded on IEEE DDP?
Okay. See, whenever we develop any module, you refer any research, public research paper, you have to prove that your technique is better than or equivalent to other technique. So to compare that, we have to use the same database what others are used. So for example, I mentioned here on Canada database. This is developed by somebody and that is a universal database. Everybody is using this database. Yes, but everybody is trying their own local database also. for example, Indian facial expression database. Unfortunately, there is no standard Indian facial expression database. Everybody has developed on their own. For example, there is one database available on the internet that is called Senthil database, S-E-N-T-H-I-L, Senthil. This database, they have developed it for their personal use, but fortunately, it is available on the website. Second, I have developed in my college from the students, but we have not make it public because the database also includes the faces of other people, and with their consent in writing, we cannot do that, so we don't do it. Now, there is another database which is available on the web, that is Indian database taken from facial expression of actor and actresses on the Indian movie. So, because Indian movies are public and that face can be utilized, so that database is available, and the name of the database is Indian Movie Face Database. Indian Movie Face Database. It is available on the web. It is available freely. You can download it. But you know, these are realistic images. If you use these images for your system, efficiency will be very, very less. So it is better that you develop your own database in your campus and then do the experimentation. Or otherwise, Senthil database is there. Some people are developing IIT also. If you search it, there is no standard Indian face database. People are developed for their own use. Over.
Okay, sir. There's one more last question now from Arya Samar, again from Vidyalanka School of Information Technology. The question is, given the current market perspective, is it beneficial to learn open source computer vision frameworks such as OpenCV or to learn proprietary computer vision services such as AIWS, Gluon CV, and such other platforms?
If you use any particular platform, then there'll be a constraint. Everybody is not using the same platform. So when we talk about learning, learning should be applicable to any environment. If you study one particular framework and if you join some industry and if they are not using that framework, then your learning has no meaning. After joining that organization, if they're using that particular framework, then you can learn that. Then there's no problem. So it is always better that you learn in general, global perspective. So that is using OpenCV on computer vision platform. So it is better that you do the course of computer vision online course, and there you use Intel OpenCV packages. That is most appropriate because they can be imported in any application. They are available for free of charge, and you can develop any application using them. In fact, in Python language also you can import it. But if you study any particular package, then your knowledge will be limited to use that only. And nothing is that easy. You need to invest your time and money. And afterwards, if that has not consideration after graduation, then it's of no use. So I always recommend to study basic things and in more wider sense. Better to use OpenCV Intel platform.
Thank you, sir. Those were all the questions. I now request Vignesh to take over. Vignesh?
Yes, am I audible?
Very much.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am. And thank you, Kiran, sir, for this wonderful session. I'm Vignesh Prabhu, the treasurer of IEEE BSIT student branch. So we have almost reached the conclusion of this webinar and as well as MindQuest webinar series. So let's hear from the two people who have attended this event on all 5 days about their experience of attending the series. So first, I would like to invite Dr. Vinit Kotak, the Vice Chair of IEEE Bombay Section and Vice Principal of Shyam Ankar Kachhi Engineering College, to share his experience. Over to you, sir.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue.
First of all, on behalf of IEEE Bombay Section, I take this opportunity to congratulate the management, the principal, the vice principal, the heads of the department, IEEE branch counselor, IEEE branch mentor, and of course, the most worked out team of IEEE VSIT team for this wonderful webinar series, the Mind Quest in quarantine. I will classify every event, I mean the success of every event, into three parts, you know, the pre-event, the post-event, the conduction of the event, and of course the post-event. When it came to the pre-event of this specific webinar series, we have all seen that the selection of the topics was fantastic. The selection of speakers, of course, with the support of Bombay section, definitely it was seen that it was proper justice was done to this. But then at the same time, I liked was the posters which were designed, they were all self-explanatory, you know, and the icing on the cake was the awareness, the method of creating awareness amongst the whole fraternity, because of which we got such an overwhelming response from the participants. So this was something really fantastic. And also to add up to that, the team has really taken a lot of pains of, communicating to every participant and keeping them updated at every moment about what will be happening next. Coming to the conduction of event, well, let me tell you, I have actually attended almost throughout this lockdown so many webinars, maybe on an average not less than 7 per day. And this is one webinar series where I found that the conduction of the event was done in such a wonderful formal manner, keeping in mind all the IEEE standards, that kudos to the IEEE VSIT team. Really, hats off to you people. To add up to that, you know, it was actually a big surprise for me. I'll confess, I'm very sorry if I have underestimated the competency of this team. But let me tell you, I was totally taken I was totally surprised by one thing. In every webinar, the volunteer used to, declare that you will get the certificate after, 1 week or maybe 1 day or 2 days. And here what happens is, the moment the participants, I don't know whether even these participants have also experienced themselves, that the moment you fill up the feedback form, and immediately in the next maybe the 60 seconds or maybe 120 seconds, an email pops up in their inbox stating that here is your certificate, here is the participation link, and of course the link for the YouTube channel. I mean, such professionalism I have not come across any webinar throughout this lockdown period specifically, because where, everybody is so much involved, and I'm sure that this IEEE VSIT volunteers definitely might also be loaded with their own academic webinars from their own teachers, and out of that, taking out this time is, it's just commendable. So congratulations to the whole team. On behalf of IEEE Bombay section, let me thank all the participants also, because had it not been for them, this webinar would have had no meaning at all. So let me thank all of them. And of course, let me thank the management, the principal, vice principal, of course, the HOD, staff members, counselor, mentor, and the IEEE VSIT team for making this a wonderful successful event, and enlightening people like me, because let me be very honest, keeping people like me stick to the screen, stick listening to that whole seminar for the at least 1 hour was a big challenge for me. But I mean, for this webinar series, I never found it difficult in sitting throughout the day. So looking forward for many such wonderful series of webinars from this team. And all the best, and God bless all of you. Stay home and stay safe. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Those were really kind and motivating words. Next, I request Mrs. Megha Kolekar, the Associate Professor of EXTC Department at Angels Vashi, with 23 years of teaching experience, to share her experience about this whole webinar series. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much, organizers, for giving me this opportunity to express. It was indeed a very fruitful webinar series. The speakers are eminent personalities in their respective fields, and all of them very passionately gave us the insights in these topics. The topics were diverse, but indeed supplementing each other in a bigger picture. The speakers were generous enough to discuss the contemporary use cases with us and share many of the algorithmic data as well. The content was very, very interesting. And that's what kept us glued to the screens, keep coming back every day. And I'm sure none of us felt like switching our screens during these talks. We enjoyed them a lot. I think the biggest takeaway from this entire series is the motivation to get into the depths of these fields with the resources that the speakers have shared with us and the organizers have very promptly provided us on the mail. I congratulate Dr. Sarika and the organizing team of faculty and students especially, who have done a really fantastic job while organizing this series. Nowhere the audience really felt any different than sitting in an auditorium and attending. A very smooth and memorable event, I must say, and I once again thank all the organizers for making us a part of this whole web series. Thank you so much. Over.
That's so nice of you to say, ma'am. Thank you very much. Now I would like to invite our very dear principal of VSIIT, Dr. Rohini Kelkar, to address the audience.
Hello, everyone. Hello, students. Hello, VSIIT IEEE team. Actually, I have nothing to say now when Vinit sir and Megha madam has already spoken about the conduct as well as the content of this web series. I'm really very fortunate to have, you know, the students, volunteers like you people, students, and obviously the VSIIT teacher team to conduct this kind of activities. We always have, and particularly as Vinit sir said about the IT component, that, you know, certificates are being given immediately and the publicity being done. And VSIIT is really fortunate to have such students. So congratulations, students. Please keep it up. And particularly during this time of lockdown, I hope the content of the web series has added to your expertise. I also thank every participant, the student participant, as well as the teacher participant from non-VSIIT institutions, and also all the well-known experts who have made this web series a success from our side, the planning side. Over to Sarika.
Thank you, ma'am. Those words were really encouraging for us, and we will perform better in the future to come. Now, I request Dr. Sarika Chauhan, the Chief Academic Officer of VSIIT and Branch Counselor of VSIIT Student Branch, to present the vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Vignesh. So, good afternoon, everyone. Hi, Dr. Sarika Chauhan, Branch Counselor, IEEE VSIIT Student Branch. I'm happy to take this opportunity to present the vote of thanks. I would like to start by thanking Mr. Kiran Talele for being a part of the MindQuest webinar series and sharing his knowledge with all attendees. The MindQuest series has been put together with a lot of care by so many people collectively, and I want to thank each and every one who has contributed to making it a success. First, I would like to express my gratitude to our dearest Dr. Rohini Kelkar, Principal Ma'am of VSIIT, Mr. Asif Rampurawala, Vice Principal, VSIIT, and VDT Management for providing us with an environment that fosters growth and new ideas and making sure we are organized and equipped at every step of the venture. I would also like to thank IEEE Bombay Section and all its speakers, Mr. Abhay Pansekar, Dr. B. Satyanarayana, Dr. Saurabh Mehta, Dr. Irfan Langre, and Mr. Kiran Talele for their cooperation and invaluable contribution to the event. We have been fortunate to have speakers that are exceptionally knowledgeable in their respective subjects, and it clearly shows in the number of people who came to attend their talk. The speakers are indeed the ones who have made this event a success. I also must mention my deep sense of appreciation for the active participation of the attendees, who all have been very cooperative and kind We have done our best to ensure you all had a smooth experience while attending the webinar series. In the background of the event, a highly dedicated team with my colleagues, Ms. Ketki Ghavli and Ms. Seema Bhatkar, branch mentors, IEEE VSIT student branch, and young students have been tirelessly completing their task ahead of time to ensure everything goes on smoothly. All the core team members, Arya, Khushi, Vinayak, Vignesh, Rajiv, Sarvesh, Pradnesh, Siddhi, Vriti, Vaishnavi, and Karishma, and all the other student team members who all have accomplished their task unbelievably well. I must say, as a newly found committee members, you all are off to an incredible start. Thank you, everyone. With that, I would like to conclude my vote of thanks. Stay home, stay safe. Only a few instructions for everyone. I hope everyone has filled the feedback form for their webinar, which was shared in the chat box. If not, kindly fill it before leaving the webinar. You will receive an e-certificate of participation within 1 week on the submission of your feedback. As early as we will send emails to registered attendees to fill the feedback in case you miss it out. Please ensure you submit it by today. The email will also give you access to the presentation and recording of today's webinar, as it will be uploaded on the YouTube channel of IEEE VSIT student branch. For any queries, you can write it to us on IEEEVSIT@gmail.com. Thank you so much, all of you, for being with us for this 5 days of webinar series MindQuant. Thank you, everyone.